Good morning, church. Good morning. Happy Father's Day. So if you're a dad, why don't you raise your hand? Bada boom. We got lots of dads here today. And if you brought your dad, raise your hand. You get extra points for bringing a dad. That's your husband. That's not your dad. Well, good morning. Let's invite the Holy Spirit into our service this morning. Dear Heavenly Father, just ask that you would just flood in here. God, that your Holy Spirit would fill this room. I push back any type of demonic spirit that might be coming against our service. In the name of Jesus, we call out witchcraft. You have no place here. You must go. In the mighty name of Jesus, I decree and declare blessing on every family here, every father here. Jesus, I just ask for you to meet us here today, Lord. Meet us here. We thank you for this day in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Melody. middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive. Let worship turn into revival.
There's nothing like your presence, Hallelujah. Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
We honor you, Lord.
Glory.
Hallelujah, Jesus.
Thank you, Father.
Hallelujah,
thank
Lord.
You, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies.
We love you, Jesus.
Till all my fears are gone and I'm no longer a slave to fear, for I am a child of God. Yes, I'm no longer a slave to fear, for I am a child of God.
Hallelujah. As we sing this morning, just make it your prayer. We don't have to live in fear or in bondage, because we are child of the Most High God.
From my mother's womb, you have chosen me. Your love has called my name. And I've been born again into a family. Your blood flows through my veins. And I'm no longer a slave to fear, for I am a child of God.
I don't care what the enemy tells you.
You're no longer a slave to fear, for I am a child of God.
We're going to sing that chorus again. Just declare it this morning.
I'm no longer a slave to fear, for I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear, for I am a child of God.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Songs of deliverance. We've been liberated.
Amen.
From our bondage. We're the sons and the daughters.
So come on, let's sing it.
So let us sing our freedom. We sing, whoa, whoa.
Sometimes we don't know what to say.
Whoa,
we groan and we pray before the Lord.
Whoa,
and He hears our heart as we sing it.
Whoa, stand and sing. I am a child of God.
We're going to sing that one more time. Just sing it with us this morning.
You split the sea so I could walk right through it. My fears were drowned in perfect love. You rescued me so I could stand and sing. I am a child of
Worship, won't you raise your hands this morning to the Lord. Father, we thank you. We thank you, Lord God, that you are good. You are the good Father, Lord God. You look over us and watch over us, Father. You bless us, God. You meet our needs, Lord. And Father, we give you the praise and the glory this morning on this Father's Day. We ask, Lord, that you would just open our hearts and move in this service today. Lord, even though it's a special day, a Father's Day, Lord, we ask, Lord, that the power of the Holy Spirit would be in this room, Father God, to make the changes and to help us and to heal us, Father God, in Jesus' name. Lord, for those, Lord, that are sick in their bodies today, we ask, Lord, that your healing power would begin to flow, even, Lord, in the midst of this service right now, Father, that you would move, God, in Jesus' name, and touch hearts and lives, God. Touch bodies, Father God. Heal, Father, in Jesus' name, God. Set us free. Set us free, Lord, from the trap of the enemy, Father God, in Jesus' name. Lord, we give you praise and glory and thank you. Thank you, Lord, for meeting us here today, in Jesus' name. If you agree with that, say amen this morning. Amen. You can kind of look around and wink at each other. And we are glad that you're here. Happy Father's Day. The biggest shopping day of the year. Come on, it's right up there with Black Friday. There's Black Friday and Father's Day. That's true. For soap on a rope and Brute by Fabergé, High Karate. How many remember? How many remember High Karate? Sorry, some of you might still wear it, but that was back in the 60s. High Karate, Brute by Fabergé. What was some other ones that? JD's, yeah. And then there was another one that, Old Spice. My dad wore that his whole life. I can't think. It started with a V. It was some cologne. You could actually use it for a torch, too. You put a... Well, happy Father's Day. We want to thank Neil came and set us up our... This is our... I know you probably thought I've been so excited about church. I'm camping out here during the week. But so Neil came and set this up for us for our Father's Day camping theme. We're going to do a little something special today rather than me tell all their fathers how bad they're doing. We're going to celebrate dads today. I had top five things here that you'll never hear your dad say. So dad's talking to their kids. You'll never hear your dad say, "What do you need a job for? I got plenty of money." You never hear dad say that. You never hear your dad say this: "Your mother and I are going away for the weekend. I think you should consider throwing a party." You never hear your dad say this: "Here's the credit card and the keys to my new car. Go crazy." Here's one: "Son, I noticed that your friends are all smart, Alex. I kind of like that." This is the top one. You'll never hear your father say, "Well, how about that? It looks like I'm lost. I'm going to have to stop and ask for directions." You notice when you get lost, this is so true. Chris and I were talking about this morning. When you get lost, the first thing you do is you turn your radio down. You ever notice that? If you're a dad, if he's lost, that's the signal that he's lost. He turns the radio down because he's trying to think. In my experience in the last 35 or 40 years in ministry, I've been through 35 or 40 Mother's Days and Father's Days, and I have noticed that there was a difference. On Mother's Day, we come and our moms are all here, and we hear messages about how great our moms are, which, you know, we should hear that because our moms are great. Actually, we wouldn't be here without our moms, right? So we celebrate our moms, but that's not what I want to talk about today. I noticed a trend that seems to take place on Father's Day, and it seems that on Father's Day messages, you hear something different. Instead of how great you are, you hear, like, "We sure appreciate you. We know you're doing the best you can. But doggone it, looks like you can do a little bit better." You know, bless your heart. So we tell moms how great they're doing, and we tell dads how they can improve. Is this true or not? Now, to prove this, I want you just to look around the room. It's mostly women here today. Dads know. Come on. Now, so I'm just telling the dads, if they're watching online today, that we're going to break this trend. Dads know that when you come to Father's Day messages, they're going to hear how they can improve. Which, you know, sometimes we need that, but that's not what... We're going to change history today at the House Hilo. Because today we're going to hear about the good things our dads did. We're going to hear about the positive things that our dads did to help us. Today we're going to celebrate dads. Some of us, you know, our dads are not with us anymore, so we're going to have to celebrate them in heaven. And I'm celebrating my dad's Father's Day today as he's in heaven. I know that he's there. And matter of fact, that picture that you're seeing there, that's probably what he looks like now. And if you think about it, in heaven, you know, he died when he was 94. Well, I got some more pictures I'll show you of him, but 94. So, but in heaven, he's not going to be 94 years old. Even though he was still pretty alert and you know, and spry, he actually worked the day he died, he was working. He was still had his own driver's license. I wouldn't ride with him, but... Because he was dangerous driving. He would run into people. This is true. I didn't plan on telling you this. I'll just tell you this. So he can't give me a whipping no more. So he'd be in parking lots and back into people and get out and look. Now that's about $200. And drive away. He would never give us driver's license or nothing. So he appraised their dents that he backed into their car. He did that several times and got away with it.
That's his soul.
Oh, I got another one. I'm going to tell you another one. So we didn't want him driving anymore because he really got bad. So we took his cars away. And he was in the car business for years. And so he hated that. And so he would sneak around and try to buy cars. And so my niece, it was my niece that talked to this guy that had a car for sale. And my dad called him. Now, we didn't know none of this. My dad called him and said, "You bring that car over here. I want to take a look at it." And so the guy brought the car over, and my dad said, "Well, I need to drive it." And so they were driving, and the guy looked at my dad, and he said, "How old are you?" He said, "Well, I'm 94. And he goes, "Pull this car over." He said, You probably don't have a driver's license." And my dad said, "I'm not pulling the car over. You leave me out here." And he drove back home. The guy wouldn't sell him the car. I found this passage of scripture in Genesis chapter 18, verse 19. I've never used this in a Father's Day message, but it's a really great scripture for Father's Day. Genesis 18, 19. This is God speaking to Abraham. He said, for I know him. Speaking about Abraham, he said, "For I know him in order that he may command his children and his household after him, that they might keep the way of the Lord and do righteousness and justice, that the Lord might bring to Abraham what he has spoken to him." So, you know, what did God speak to Abraham? But this, he promised him that his children would be blessed after him. And you know, as a dad, I have five kids. You always want your kids to do better than you did. That's truth. I mean, you know, you hear that when you're a kid and you think, you don't really mean that. But that is really the truth. You want your kids to exceed, to do better and to go farther than you did. And that's a promise that God gives us as parents, especially as fathers, is that if we know him and we lead our families in the way of righteousness and justice, that this promise would come to our family, that he would be a blessing to our children. And then there's another one, that this is the first commandment that God gave that has a promise tied to it. It's in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 1 through 4. It says, "Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise." Listen, and here's the promise, that it might be well with you and that you might live long on the earth. And so if you as a child want to extend your life, you need to be kind to your parents. Be kind. Parents, that'd be a good time to say amen. "And you fathers, do not provoke your children to wrath, but bring them up in the training and the admonition of the Lord." You know, as fathers, God has given us a mandate, and that mandate is this, is that we are to be the leaders of our home. And I think that many times why Father's Day messages tend to go towards the things that we fall short in is that many times we do fall short. I'm going to try to stay off of telling you what you're doing wrong. But the Bible does tell us that we are to be the leaders of our home. The Bible tells us that we are to be the priests of the home. And what does that mean, to be the priests of the home? That we are to lead our family spiritually. Guys, if you really want your wife to like you, be the priest of the home. Ladies, that would have been a great time to say amen. I'm going to try that again. Guys, if you really want your wife to like you, be the priest of the home.
Amen.
Pray with your wife.
Amen.
You know, read the Bible with them. Okay, and so that's, you know, another job that God gives us, is that we are, as the priests of the home, supposed to be the example of you know, our kids seeing us reading the Bible and studying God's Word. The Bible says this, that we are to train our children in the way that they should go. And so, you know, God gives us plenty of instruction on the things that we are supposed to do and should do. And you know, and sometimes even, you know, Chrissy talked about this in her Mother's Day message, that sometimes even when we do our job as parents and we train them up in the way of the Lord, that sometimes they go south. How many know that? They become prodigals. They walk away from God. It happens. It happens quite frequently, maybe too often. It does happen. But the Bible promises this: if we've done our job, God will do his. if we've done our job, if we've trained our children in the way of the Lord, that when they get old, the Bible says that they will not depart from it. They will come back. And so you might have, listen, you might have a prodigal out there. I wasn't going to preach this morning. I'm going to start to preach. You might have a prodigal out there. And you've brought them up to know the Lord. Listen, God promises you this, that he's going to bring them back.
Amen.
He's going to bring them back home. And, you know, and they're going to be back in church. And you're going to see that. And you're going to witness that. We're celebrating dads today. So instead of preaching messages on how we can do better, we're going to hear, what we're going to do is we're going to hear from four different fathers here in our congregation, four different dads. And what we want to do, and this is unrehearsed. I gave them the question so they could think about it, but we don't know the answers, so I don't know how they're going to turn out. Hopefully, they turn out good. But they're going to talk about their experiences with their dad growing up, and I'm going to throw my experiences in there too. So I got five or six questions that we're going to ask all of them the same thing, and they're going to answer that. But before we do that. Matter of fact, while they're setting the stage up, we can move those chairs over. Pastor Christie is. How many guys did all the fathers get? Did all the fathers get a ticket when they came in? Did any fathers not? I'll put it this way: did any fathers not get a ticket when they came in? Everybody got one. Okay, so Christie. So instead of, you know how you normally like. Some dads will never win these, you know, when you have like the dad with the most kids or the most baby mamas, and so some are never going to win those. And so we're going to do it different this time. And I'm just being real. I can be real. And we're going to, so maybe you'll win today. Okay.
So before we get started, I just want to honor you this morning.
That mic's on, I don't think.
Looks like somebody else. Hello. It's on. You are a fantastic father. I know if any of your children were here this morning, they would honor you like this. If I had to be a kid, you would have been a great pick as a father. You're a great dad. Great dad.
Thank you.
So, love you.
Thank you.
Great dad.
Thank you.
If you need any parental counseling, this is your guy.
Thank
now let's
much.
Get
Thank
to
you.
The gifts. You pay me later for saying that, okay? Is
okay,
there any
so,
ladies available to help me with some runners?
Oh, I was getting ready to go on with my service.
I know you were.
You do a service over there, and I'll do one over here. And we'll. All right, so go ahead.
Do one. Okay, so hold on. Let me hand you guys the...
Looks like some good gifts over there that I don't have a ticket, that I don't have a ticket to. Big envelopes of cash.
Okay, so everybody get your ticket out. We're gonna do some drawing, raffle.
Oh, you're
gonna draw it?
Okay. I'll draw. That way you know it's legal.
I wouldn't let you have a ticket. So for the first item, it is a house, the House Hilo notepad, leather bound, with a matching pen. Pastor Rachel has it right there. That could be yours.
Vanna Rachel.
If your number is 530-627.
Yes!
All right, right up front. Good job.
Yeah. You almost...
Here, check his number.
I think prophetically you knew you were going to win that.
I know,
the way he was like.
We have a King James Version Bible, which is, actually, is that new or is it regular? New King James, which is just as good as the old King James, a little bit easier to read. That would be, if you get this, you have to start doing Bible studies with your children, okay? 530-639.
Oh, there you go. Hey, this is not rigged. This is kind of looking rigged here, but if I win one, we know it's rigged. So
I'm sure he already does that. Okay, how about for another notepad and pen? 530. I think that's a theme.
Five three zero. That's all of them.
632.
Look.
Oh, Pastor Clint. Gotta put. God, Pastor Clint.
I guess, you know, just the pastors are winning here.
Pastor Harlan, it looks like you're next. Okay, this is going to be for the house jacket.
The house jacket.
Yeah, hold that house jacket up.
Look, show that.
Yeah, show that off.
Look at that.
Show that off. Okay. I wish we had more of these guys, but you may have to share. All right, for the house zip-up jacket, 530-631. 631. Woo, right
oh,
there.
Oh, there we go.
Right there. Congratulations.
Congratulations.
You have to model that for
yeah,
us, too.
You have to wear that the rest of the service.
5-3, oh, sorry, 4, we have a massage coupon up here.
Massage?
Yes, Danny and Sheila were nice enough to donate this. If you've never gotten a massage by them, you're in for a treat. 530-641. 641.
Back here in the back. All right.
All right. Good job. Good job. Kind of fun, we should do this.
Yeah.
Give your layaway too.
Yeah.
Start giving stuff away.
Chrissy says it's so much fun. She wants to give a lot of stuff away.
I'm a salesman at heart, so I like to sell.
Let's see.
Are you ready? Who's it gonna be? 530. I think we got that.
What are you giving
six,
away?
Oh, the notepads. Yep. Nope. Right there. Pastor Sheena has it. Good job. 643. 643. 530. 643. Good job. Oh, who did it go to?
Byron, is that you?
Where's
643?
All the way in the back.
Where's it at?
Good job.
Oh, okay.
Right on.
Oh, all right.
Winner, winner, chicken dinner. I think we're on our last one, right? Okay, everybody who's feeling lucky, get ready. Say a little prayer. Okay. And 530-640. 640.
Oh, Stan.
Woo! Good job.
That it?
So happy Father's Day to all of you. You're all winners. And we have some chocolates for you when you leave today. Make sure you get a box, okay? God bless.
And listen, if you didn't win in this service, come back to the next one.
And get another ticket.
Yeah. Same service, but you might win, so. Okay. So listen, thank you, Pastor Chrissy. At this time, we want to have Pastor Marty come up, and Pastor Harlan, Pastor Rocky, and Maestro Drew. Drew is the maestro of the sound system. Pastor Marty's doing this so whenever he starts leaping and jumping, you're going to see the difference. All right. Are our contestants ready? Okay, so we came up with six questions. Actually, I came up with them. And then gave the questions to these guys so they could think about them this week. So hopefully you have some answers. And did you guys write them down, or are you going to just answer from memory?
I'm going to wing it from my heart.
You're going to wing it? Okay. Since I didn't have pictures of your guys' dad, I did have mine. And so we're going to throw some pictures of him up there. So the first question was this. Actually, Pastor Harlan came up with this one. How would you describe your dad in 5 words or less? Pastor Harlan?
Describe my dad is a man of few words. If you know my dad, he's a man of few words.
A man of few words. Okay.
Fine. All right.
All right. If I could describe my dad. My dad, if you look at him, you guys know who Dog the Bounty Hunter is? He is business in the front, party in the back? Okay. So my dad, he looks intimidating and scary, but he's kind, he's loving, he's a hard worker, and he's just overall a good man.
Good. Amen.
Oh, you stole my thunder. Oh. Yeah. My dad was kind and loving. Yeah, a good man, a good man.
Mine comes a little bit of a story. Fun and hurting people hurt people. So my dad went through a lot, and is still going through a lot. So he's either fun or it's an example of hurting people hurt people.
Right. Right. And actually, which goes to show, you know, not everybody had a perfect relationship with their dad. There are a lot of men that had some challenges, you know, growing up with their dad, which we'll talk more about that in a little while. If I was describing my dad, I wrote down five things. He was hardworking, had great work ethic. He was creative. He loved God. He was big-hearted, and he was giving. So that's how I describe him. Okay, second question. What is your favorite memory of your dad? Pastor Harden.
Favorite memory of my dad. I think it was last year or a couple years ago. Actually, it was a year. I think me, my dad, and my brother Michael went to Hawaiian Style Cafe, and we just had a meal together. And I think that's the first time we really talked about his story, where he came from. And I was in awe, because my dad is a man of few words. But he opened up and he shared a lot to me and my brother, and I got more insight of my dad and who he is. And yeah, I think that was the best memory that I can take with me.
So hearing his life stories. Yeah,
yes.
Great.
I think that was the greatest thing, because my dad didn't really talk about his stories when he was young. And so I think that would really, and when he went to the Army, he shared a lot.
Right.
It was a lot. And I was very grateful that he did, because it really got me understand him more as a man.
Right.
For my dad. So, yeah.
Great.
Awesome. Just a little history. And like you said, not all dads are perfect, right? Growing up, I grew up in a broken home. You know, my mom and dad was divorced when I was 5 years old. So being that my dad, yes, he made mistakes along his way. But my memory of my dad is my dad is a cowboy. He's a Paniolo. He used to work up at Kuhu Ranch. And every summer, we would go live with him for the summer. And he would take us horseback riding, go hunting in the mountains long time in the mountains. I went to come home, but no, we're going to catch a pig. We're going to catch a cow. He was like, oh, Dad, please, Dad. I want to go home already. But yeah, we'll make sure we cut all the meat up there, bring all the trimmings back, you know, and he would cook, you know. So that was my favorite memories. And so we'll go from the mountain, and then we'll go all the way down to the ocean, go swim in Hapuna. And he would always make sure that you know, we had a nice time with him. So that's my memory of my pops.
Amen. Yeah, that's good.
My pops.
Your pops. my dad, I used to enjoy his stories about growing up in Kau'u and the things he used to do. But one thing that sticks out in my mind is when, in the evenings when he'd be at home, he and I would sit out on the back porch, and I'd have my ukulele and he'd have his guitar. And he would teach me the songs that he had growing up, you know, and also I wouldn't know too many songs, but you know, he was humble enough to just let me take the lead sometimes, and we'd play together. So that was those are memories of my dad.
Amen.
It's a good memory. It's a good memory. Like I said, my dad was a lot of fun. When I was a kid, there was a lot of silly, fun things that we did. But the first thing that came to mind was we used to go canoeing. My parents had a canoe. My dad was always in the back. My sister and I were in the middle on a fiberglass canoe, so it wasn't very comfortable. But we enjoyed it. My mom was in the front, you know, just paddling. And I remember one time my dad said, hey, paddle fast. And my mom was like, I'm paddling fast. He said, no, fast, fast, fast. And they were paddling, and the boat was rocking, and the water was going everywhere. And we looked back, and there was a Department of Land and Natural Resources boat, a motorboat behind us trying to catch us and pull us over to make sure we had life preservers, which we didn't. We had enough for my sister and I, my mom, but my dad didn't have a preserver. So he thought he was going to out-paddle a boat on a river. So we had a lot of good times on that boat, a lot of itchiness from the fiberglass, but that was a really, really good memory of him out trying to outrun a motorboat. Good
times. Rocky reminded me of my dad actually made me hate fishing. And I like it now, but growing up, he made me go fishing. And all my brothers and sisters, we all had to go fishing with him. And he didn't want to go home. He would stay there, and he would fish all night if you didn't cry enough. And you would say, like, Dad, all right, can we go? And he goes, oh, just a minute, I just got a bite. I just got a bite. And that was his saying. My dad was growing up. This is he and my mom when they were younger. But growing up, you know, my dad was always in business for himself. He rode motorcycles, kind of a rough guy, bar fighter. When my oldest brother was born, my dad was in the coma in the hospital from a bar fight. Got hit in the head with a beer bottle filled with salt, and his tooth was knocked out in the front. His whole life, his tooth was knocked out in the front. But he would have this grin. He'd give you this grin with that tooth missing. And that was one of the first memories that came to my mind. His stories. And so several of these guys talked about the stories. My dad had great stories. And so that's really something for us to learn as dads, is our kids want to know those stories. You know, they want to know the things that happened to us growing up. And, you know, my dad was born in 1918, and so he was raised during the Depression. Would never throw anything away, because most people in the Depression raised in that era didn't waste anything, didn't throw anything away, which made him a little bit of a hoarder. But, the road trips, we were in business together for many years, and so we'd have to go to New Mexico and Arizona. And we did these road trips that would last, you know, 5, 6, 7 days at a time. And so you'd hear those stories. And some of these days I'll tell you some crazy stories that, not real Christian, but real crazy stories. Although he did become a Christian later on in his life. There's one memory that I have of him, and I'm going to tell you that towards the end. But so that was our memories of our dads. The next question is this: what is the funniest thing that you ever saw your dad say or do?
Well, my dad is a joker. I found that way later in life. But one memory that came popping to my head was, my dad is very a clean person. He likes to wash his clothes and do stuff. But there's one incident with my sister. I think they came to a party. I have no idea. I can't remember the details. But all I remember is she was sleeping. My dad dragged her out of bed and brushed her teeth, screaming, crying, brush your teeth, you have to brush your teeth. And the why is so funny to me, because I do the same thing. I don't know why. I just like, they have to brush your teeth. I don't care, coming from a party, or they have to brush, they wake him up, we'll drag him to the bathroom, and they have to brush your teeth. So that is the funniest story. I see my dad, I'm like, oh my goodness, I'm just like my dad.
Yeah, I could have told you that before you finished the story, but
crack up. The funniest memory of my dad, if you all know, my dad is pure Portuguese, okay? One pure Portuguese man, okay? So he is on joker. And my memory of a funny story was, I had no idea he had false teeth at one point. So I just remember in shock, me and my sister, just to joke around, the first time I ever saw him without his false teeth, and he was like maybe in his early 40s, okay, when this had happened. So we were just kicking back, and then he was like, hey, son, check this out. He took out his teeth, and there's no teeth in the front. And he was laughing. He was just like, whoa, what is that? What is that? It looks so different. No teeth. I was in shock, but yeah, so... Yeah, to this day, once in a while, if I'm hanging with my dad, I'll say, Dad, you take out your teeth again?
Wow. My dad could be a joker also, but one of the funniest things, and he did a number of funny things, but one of the funniest things to me, and it kind of shocked me too, because I don't know if this was before Loretta and I met. I don't know. I think it was, you know, when I was getting prepared to go off to college. And I don't know why he told me this, you know, but he says, when you go to the mainland, he said, now, you're going to see a lot of pretty howly girls over there, you know. So I want you to remember this. When you think about who you want to marry, what kind of food do you want to eat? I said, what kind of food? He goes, yeah, you want to eat the local food, you better marry a local girl. You want to eat the holly food, you can marry a holly girl. So, of course, I got the best of both worlds. I married a local holly.
A local
Funny. So my dad, as a kid growing up, there were good times and bad times, like I'm sure everyone has. But one of the funnier times, well, my dad tells a story. He gets his whole body involved, kind of like I'm doing now. And a lot of his stories that I think are funny now weren't funny at the time. I remember one time he was trying to teach me how to, he was teaching me how to play baseball and hit the ball and have it land where there wasn't a baseball player so I could actually make it to first base and then hopefully I could steal base and all that. But one of the times, you know, I was tired, ready to go home. He said, no, let's come on a few more times. So he's saying, okay, I'm going to throw the ball real slow, but I want you to hit it as hard as you can. I said, that doesn't make a whole lot of sense, but okay. So he threw the ball, kind of just tossed it, and I gave it all I had, everything I had. And popped him right in the eye.
Oh.
So it's not funny then. It's really funny now. Uh-huh. And to have him tell this story about how his hands were up to cover his face and I still got him. It's funny now. Thinking on it. It's definitely funny now.
I bet he thought that was hilarious.
He did say it was okay. He did say, hit it as hard as you can. It's not your fault that my eye is black. It's just...
Yeah. I still got another one.
Yeah.
My dad did all kinds of... These are pictures of him. You never could tell. I mean, he was a real strict father. I mean, you didn't disrespect him or you picking yourself up off the ground. That's how we were raised. They didn't have CPS in. And so... And my brothers and sisters are watching. They'll attest to that. I'm telling you the truth. And so we had a Native American art store. And so he put a headdress on and an Indian rug and walked around the store one day. And then I think on Father's Day, one of the kids had the fake nose and glasses. And I didn't think he'd do it. I said, Dad, put this on. And he put it on. Him and my mom both had them on, and you can see that's one of my daughters back there, actually two of my daughters, son-in-law, they were just, everybody was just busting up. He was probably 90 when this picture was taken. So, when you got that long with them, that there's a lot of memories, you know. They did a lot of funny things. And then, like Drew was saying, sometimes they're funny to you and not to them, or maybe funny to your family and other people wouldn't get it. And so I think that's probably what makes us a family, huh? Okay, so number four, what was the best advice or wisdom that your dad ever shared with you?
I think for my dad was, he didn't say much, but he lived it out more than what he said. You know how action speaks louder than volume? So he actually lived out his life more than what he said to me. And I think just watching him realize that, wow, I mean, he did it more, because he's a hard worker. He always was up early doing stuff, and he lived out more example for me to follow than what he said to me.
Mm-hmm.
So that's pretty much.
Good.
Yep.
Best advice my dad gave me. My dad gave me a lot of good advice, funny advice, but the one that sticked out to me, and like I said, you know, my dad wasn't perfect. You know, growing up, my dad had a ton of mistakes with my mom and stuff, but, you know, it's all forgiven in the past. But I just remember one time, and I was growing, I think I graduated high school. I don't know if I was dating my wife yet at the time, but I remember he grabbed me. Oh, yes, I was, yeah. That's what I was. Yeah, that's right. Thank you, Dad. I have an awesome father-in-law. Oh. Yes. Yeah, my mind went blank right there. Okay. I dated her in my 10th grade, 11th grade year. Anyway, okay. Out of high school, my dad pulled me and my brothers, and he was crying. And I was like, oh, man, I never seen my dad cry like this before. He must be, you know, he wants to tell us something, like, really serious. But he told us boys that, he said, you guys are my sons. He said, I just want to let you guys know that what daddy did a long time ago to mommy was very wrong. And I don't want you to end up like me. And daddy is very sorry to you guys. And when you guys get you guys' wives, or your wives now, you guys respect her and love her as she should. And I remember that.
Amen.
And I was like, oh, thank you, Dad. You know, take that to heart. So thank you. And I have a loving, beautiful wife.
Amen.
Here. Take care.
Pastor Harlan and Pastor Rocky said, it was more for me, it wasn't anything he said, but it was his actions. You know, you knew he was the way he housed, the leader of our family, and you know, and the way he, you know, loved us. He was a hard worker. You know, that spoke out to me. And you know, and even like, you know, I remember one time I got, you know, don't get me wrong, I, you know, I created a bunch of, you know, I wasn't the best kid, but then, you know, one time I got blamed wrongly for something that happened, and he came home from work to apologize to me. I was wondering, Dad, how come you're at home? You know, and he came home, and he sat me down, and he was in tears because he, you know, because of what he did, and, you know, that spoke volumes to me, and also the fact that he was never afraid for us kids to be better. He, you know, like Pastor Tom said, we, you know, we all, you know, we as parents want our kids to be better than us, and also he wasn't afraid for you know, he wasn't afraid for each of us kids to be better than him. You know, both he and my mom were like that. They wanted us to excel. And so, you know, and that's something I, you know, that I try to teach our kids too, that, you know, I'm not afraid. And, you know, if any of your teachers shouldn't be afraid for you. They should want you to be better than them, you know, because, you know, it's a testament to us that our kids are better than us.
Amen.
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 Like Pastor Tom said, there wasn't CPS when I was growing up. So discipline was primarily done in my house by my father, who had a belt, which I believe in. But one of the advices that he gave me that always stuck with me, and he didn't tell me until much later in my life. I wish he had told me like 2 days after I got my correction. But he told me he always cried after he disciplined me. And he told me that... this is before I had kids of my own, to always pray before I disciplined my children. At the time, when he told me, I said, I wish you had prayed for restraint. But what it taught me was to go into that corrective action with the right frame of mind. And that is corrective action, not punishment. To be honest, I think the beatings were better because a couple hours later, I wasn't punished anymore. So these 30-day punishments and weeks without your phone, that's worse for me. Yeah. But I think the idea of, you know, him telling me that he cried after the discipline really said that it wasn't something he wanted to do,
right,
which for 18 years I didn't believe. it definitely has made me a better father myself.
Right. Yeah, and I think kids need to hear that too. Your parents don't enjoy disciplining you. You know, so then quit messing up. So that's, you need to hear that. You have a long life. I wrote down 3 or 4 things here. My dad was he got saved when I was about 25 years old and served the Lord with all his heart, him and my mom both, the rest of their lives. And so I remember it was before I became a Christian. I think I was just turning 21, and I was going to a casino. Now, my dad was a gambler, and he had, you know, he was reformed. He was an alcoholic, a gambler. He did everything you shouldn't do, and set that example, you know. So we learned things that we shouldn't do from the things that we saw him do. But, you know, he didn't want us to follow in his footsteps. And so I remember when I was probably 21, 22 years old, I was going to Laughlin, Nevada, or Las Vegas. We lived down there. And I was going to the casino, and he didn't want me to go. And I said, why? And he said this, which I've never forgotten it. This is what he said. He said, talking about a casino, he said, anything that backs up against the wall and challenges the world, you better leave it alone. And basically, that's what they do. They back up against the wall and challenge the world. And so that was a lot of one or two line pieces of advice that he gave that actually stuck with me, you know. And it was true. As he got older, you know, and was serving the Lord, he would always say this: you need these 3 things. He said, you need to serve the Lord. You need to pay your tithes. He always said this: I've never given God a dime that he didn't give me a dollar back. He'd tell everybody that. Never give God a dime that he didn't give me a dollar back. So you need to pay your tithes. And he said, you need to pay your taxes because the man will come get you. And he did have the man come and get him a few times. And so that was, you know, wisdom comes from both sides. Wisdom comes from things that people do right and things that people do wrong. And so if we learn from those things, then, and I think that a lot of parents, you raise your kids in a way that you were not raised because, you know, you always said, you know, when I have kids, I'll never do this to them. And sometimes that's true. And sometimes it's not. But, you learn from that, you know, my dad was, you didn't ever talk back to him, you never questioned him, that was just all the way, but I didn't raise my kids that way. I you know, they probably would say different, but I think that I let them give me their opinion and talk, and we would talk things out. With him, it's just like, there was no discussion, and Christy was raised the same way, there was just no discussion, and so... when their words said, it's done, and don't talk. We don't have nothing. What are you still here for? You got nothing more to talk about. All right, number 5. Probably for Pastor Marty and I will be different than these younger guys here. So what was the last thing you heard your dad tell you? So it was this morning for you. So.
This morning. Was it this morning?
No, I don't know if it was this morning.
That's Tom.
I wasn't there. I was just...
I think it was yesterday. He told me, he said, oh, make sure your boy eat. I was like, what the?
Make sure what?
Make sure my son eats, because when I watch him.
Because he thinks you're getting too skinny.
No, no, not me. My son, Kaipo. My son, Kaipo.
Okay.
He just make sure he eats, because when he's with me, you know, he eats when he's hungry, you know.
Uh-huh.
You know, the moms make sure they have a schedule, and, you know, they eat 3 meals a day. I'm like, ah, they're hungry. They can have a snack, go outside, have fun.
Just brush your teeth.
Brush it. Stop. Yeah, I think for me, it was like the last time, make sure your son eats. Yeah, so that's, he always reminds me that, because I just get caught up with other things.
Okay.
So, yeah, it's a good reminder.
All right.
That's the last thing he said to me.
All right, the last thing my dad said to me. See, I don't live with my dad. I usually talk to him on a phone, but growing up in my family, we always end with the word, I love you. Yes. All the time. So, like, even my kids know, before I leave it, Daddy loves you, Daddy loves you. So to this day, my dad, when he hangs up the phone, says, son, I love you. I love you too, Dad.
So, yeah.
That's always the last words. Boom. I love you.
Amen. That's good.
Well, same here. I mean, you know, that's normally the last thing, because I would always call him every Tuesday, because every Tuesday I was golfing, right? And so I would on my way down from Volcano, we'd, you know, talk, and it's actually something that both myself and my brother did. And the last thing that Dad said to me was, actually, we were golfing. Mike and I were golfing on a Good Friday, and it was, you know, Good Friday was in April, and it just happened to be a week or so, a couple of weeks before he passed away. And, you know, he was... Actually, he got to talk to Micah first, and then he talked to me, and then, and the last thing he said was, you know, I love you, and I said, you know, I love you too, Dad. And but I tried to keep it an upbeat, you know, but I knew he was saying goodbye, you know, at least from the earthly standpoint. In fact, even when I hung up the phone, Micah says, so did Grandpa try to tell you goodbye? I go, yeah, he did, but I tried to, you know, evade it, because I wanted... You know, I wanted to talk about good things, you know, because there was good things happening even up to the time that he was getting ready to go home, you know, to be with the Lord, because a lot of good things were happening. You know, a friend he had been witnessing for many years went to church with him, his grandchildren were coming along, you know, coming around. And so, you know, but the last thing he did say to me was, you know, I love you, and those will stick in me for quite a while.
So the last thing my dad said to me was, I love you, so far. But I want to go back a little bit further. When I was 13 or 14 years old, I started struggling with depression and suicide, and I decided I'm going to go in the military. Because my dad was in the military, and he always said he wished he never got out. And I said, well, that's awesome. I'll do that. And unfortunately, at the time, I thought that because I couldn't do it myself, if I was to die in the military, then that's kind of was a bonus, which is terrible to say now. But the last thing my dad said when I said goodbye to him to go into the military was, they can't kill you. And I don't know if he was speaking to my character or a simple fact that I was defiant as a kid, and he knew I was going to have drill sergeants that were going to be in my face. But that's always stuck with me all the time. We set our watches for noon, so that no matter where I was at noon, local time for him, I knew that at that time, his watch, because I had to set it, he wasn't good with electronics, that at noon, his time, he would take time out to think of me. And I actually did really well in the military, and I kind of attribute that to having a very stern father, a very direct father, but also his last words of wisdom before I left, which is, they can't kill you. It's kind of a dark message, but the good thing of it is I knew he loved me, and I knew he was saying, I will see you again very soon, and this too shall pass, and you will go on and do great things.
Right.
So I'm working on it. But I'm blessed I haven't heard the last thing he said.
Yeah. So my mom preceded my dad in death by about 8 years. And usually, you know, when they've been married for 60, 70 years, when one goes, usually the other one's not too far behind. And so my dad lived another 8 years past my mom. He lived by himself. Like I said, he still drove. He was independent. And I had one of my sisters lived, you know, right near him. And so she would, you know, make sure he had groceries and stuff like that. But then she moved to Oklahoma. And so for the last, four or five years of his life, Christy and I took care of him. And so we would go down. We lived up in Murphy's. So we'd go down on Tuesday and pick him up. And he always looked forward to that, you know. And he'd always have, you know, we would take him, get his groceries, and he'd always take us to lunch, usually the same place. He liked smorgasbords, Chinese smorgies and stuff. And then he'd always, you know, try to, like, oh, we need to go. He'd think of extra things so you would stay there longer, you know. But he always wanted to make sure that you're coming back next Tuesday, because he knew Tuesday's store was closed. And so we would, you know, Tuesdays we'd come down and get him. So we'd get his groceries, get him in the house and everything. We're trying to, you know, we have to drive another hour back up the hill to get back home. So right when we get ready to go, he would go to the door and he'd say, see you next Tuesday. He was saying that to make sure that you were going to come next Tuesday, you know, because there was some, you know, rarely did it happen that we weren't going to be there next Tuesday, and we would tell him, you know, we're not going to be here next week. But he said, see you next Tuesday. And so he always said that, and we'd get ready to walk out the door, closing the door. He'd go, see you next Tuesday. All right, see you next Tuesday, Dad. And we'd walk, you know, walk out and get in the car and go home. So the last Tuesday, actually we didn't, we were on vacation. And it was a Tuesday before we went on vacation. We didn't go by and see him. But on that day, when after we had put all of his groceries up and everything, and we're getting ready to walk out the door, Chris reminded me of this guy because I'd forgot about it. Right when we were getting ready to walk out the door, he looked at me and he said this, I'll see you soon. So I think he knew, like Marty was saying, I think that he knew that his time was coming up, even though he was healthy. And, you know, I asked the coroner, you know, when we got there to the house, I said, did he have a heart attack? And he said, no, he just died. He said, you know, he went in and took a shower. It looked like he went and took a shower, was heading back to the bedroom, and his heart just stopped. He just died. And so he didn't suffer. He didn't, you know, he just left this world and went to the next. But so that was the last thing that I heard him say to me, is that, I'll see you soon. And the advantage of having a parent that's gone to heaven, amen, is that we will see him soon. Right. We're going to see him again. Last question is this, and it'll be different for you younger guys than Pastor Marty and I probably. What would you want your dad to know if you could tell him today? And so this would be a good time to tell your dad anything that you want to tell him.
Thank you, Pastor Tom. I think for me is that I'm proud of you, Dad, for living out an example for me, and just being the great example, and seeing my dad now and before, but now he's more open, like reading the Word, and I watch, get up in the morning, I see him, and it just quickens me that my dad loves the Lord so much, and we came through so much that he still has a heart for me and always watching out for me. Mm-hmm. We live in the same house, but different. I take care of my family, but it's just, I know he cares. And I think that really reminded me that what a father should do for their kids. It doesn't matter how old you are. Like, I know my dad is still caring for me and watching for me. He sends me texts, reminded, don't forget to do this. Don't forget to do that. I was like, yes, Dad, got it. You know, and I think I didn't realize that means more to me now because I realize now that my dad is just pouring into me.
Right.
Like, don't forget to pray. Like, yes, Dad. You know, and I think that it's good that he never did that. And just I'm realizing that that is a good reminder for me because I still need my dad in my life.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So, parent, men, keep on doing to your kids. Like, I tell you, pour and tell them the stories. Man, I'm in awe when my dad told me his story about the army. It was just throw me off. Like, wow, Dad. So, like, tell them the story. Do you want to know? Okay, girls, I'll tell you the stories. Don't you worry.
Right.
But, yeah, amen. Not amen.
Right. That's good.
Amen. Amen. I thank my dad for having good DNA genes so I can be looking so handsome, you know.
That's what I was thinking that.
So. Me too, bro.
No, no. Anyway, if my dad was here and if he was listening, I just want to say, I just want to thank my dad, you know, throughout the mess, whatever happened when we were kids, that he was always there for us kids, loved on us. He was always there. You know, he could have left, you know, could have, you know, been one of those dads that, you know, never cared. But I just want to say I love him and I appreciate his love for us and for being a great dad.
Amen.
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 Amen. I would tell my dad and my mom that you did a good job. And I remember one time, I have a brother, my younger brother, he was always... You know, he's a harder worker and a smarter, and but then when my dad came to our college graduation, you know, he confessed. He says, you know, Marty, he says, I never expected you to graduate from college.
He did graduate?
I did graduate. Actually, I was pretty good at what I did. So, I mean, he says, I never expected you to graduate. I kind of. Wow. Thanks, Dad. You know, and but then he revealed to me how upset he was, you know, how bummed out he was at my brother Randy, who, you know, was only interested in surfing and you know, getting high and stuff like that, going to the beach and, you know, getting high. Does that sound familiar, Micah? You know. And in fact, yeah, he quit school, you know, Randy quit school. Then I turned to my dad, I said, you know, but Dad, you taught us well. So in the end, he will turn around, and I wasn't even a Christian yet, but that was, you know, that's Bible principle, right? You know, bring your children up in the way of the Lord, and they will, you know, they will return to it. You know, we weren't saved yet, but we were brought up with basic Christian values, we were Catholics. We went to Catholic church and went to catechism and all that. So, you know, we learned. But I told him, I said, Dad, don't worry. I said, you know, you taught him well, and eventually, you know, he'll come around. And which he did. I mean, he came around. He got his degree. You know, Randy became an attorney, and now he's retired, and I'm still working. And so, you know, but you know, yeah. Oh, I would tell him that you did good. He's good.
That's good. It's good. Now you took mine. So, like I said before, my dad and I was a little crazy as a kid, and I don't want to blame it on ADHD or anything, although I do have that. I had an issue with discipline because my father was a disciplinarian. And we didn't really see eye to eye because I wanted to do what I wanted to do, and he liked to say not another word. and the belt. but I, you know, as a kid, I guess I only saw my dad holding me back, you know, not letting me do the fun stuff. I mean, sometimes we had a lot of fun. He liked to drink too, so we had a lot of fun times. As a parent now, I see a lot of that differently. I realize that he was trying to protect me as his child. And now, me as a father, and I protect my children, I definitely see that differently. My dad and I are not as close as we were before. And now I've said things that I wish I could take back. And if I could tell him anything today that I would hope would be the real message from my heart is, I love you, and I'm looking forward to seeing you in heaven, because this earthly body is very easy to sin with, and in heaven I don't have to worry about the sins of my flesh, my anger, and all that getting in the way of the true love that I have for my dad, the desire to see him do great things. If I could see him in heaven, I'm really looking forward to the day that, you know, that I see him in heaven and get to say I love you there too.
Amen.
Amen.
I think that with my dad, especially in the last several years of his life, we really got probably the best years of our relationship. It was the best. And, you know, a lot of times when your parents pass away, we have so many regrets of things that we didn't say or things we didn't do. And, you know, in my case, I felt like I covered most of those bases. I don't have a lot of regrets of things that I didn't say to him, because he knew I loved him and he loved me. And even though we had some rocky, shaky times, you know, those things were all straightened out. And so I think that, and I do think that God allows, we have a great cloud of witnesses watching over us. I don't think that they're oblivious to what is going on in our lives today. I believe that, that our parents in heaven or your loved ones in heaven can see what's going on, hopefully just the good things, not the bad things. But I think that what I would say to my dad is what he really wanted was for me to serve the Lord. That was really what he wanted. So I would tell him I'm serving the Lord. I would tell him I'm paying my tithes and I'm paying my taxes. And I would tell him that I'm finishing this race. And I'm going to finish strong.
Come on.
Amen. And I think that as being a parent, man, what more would you want to hear from your kid? Is that they're in this race, and then they're going to finish. They're going to finish strong. I want you guys just to sit here for a minute. I'm going to just, in closing, I want to just tell you about a funeral that I went to. Several years ago, we had a guy in our ministry that his dad passed away, and I didn't really know his dad, but he asked me would I come to the funeral. I wasn't doing the funeral. I've done a lot of funerals, but I wasn't doing this funeral. He just asked me if I would attend the funeral, and I said, yeah, I'd attend the funeral, and he lived in the next town over in Ceres, California. So I came into this little Baptist church, sat in the back, and I couldn't believe what I saw. The casket was there, but there were more flowers at this funeral than I'd ever seen in my life. And I've been to a lot of funerals. I mean, like people that were very wealthy people or very important people, and you know, they had a lot of flowers. But this guy, you couldn't even see the casket. You couldn't see the front of the church. There was so many flowers. And so come to find out that he was a volunteer fireman. He was a volunteer in the police department. He was a part of the Rotary Club. He was a part of the, you know, every club that he could be part of. And so they were, you know, all these different organizations had sent the flowers and big wreaths, and they were everywhere. And I was just taken back by how many flowers there were at this funeral. And then his kids, he had three or four kids, and he had all, a bunch of grandkids, and they got up and they had letters. And like in most funerals, you know, they come and read a letter about, you know, what grandpa meant to them or what dad meant to them and the fond memories and stuff like that. And they all read their letters. And as I sat there and I listened to that, I thought, I wonder if they ever told this guy all these great things while he was alive. I wonder if they ever, you know, said, hey, let me tell you of a special memory I have with you, or something that we did together, or all the things that were in these letters, you know, and how much they loved him and how much they appreciated him. And I was just so impressed by that. And the funeral ended, and I left and went home. Actually, the following Sunday was Father's Day. My mom and dad attended the church that I worked at, marriage and family pastor. It was Calvary Temple at the time, which changed to the House Modesto. And a big church, you know, 3,000 people in a service. They always sat in the very back row. The ushers always knew where, you know, that's where they sat, and they would always seat them there. And so I would, you know, many times I'm on the front row, or a lot of times we even sat on the platform, and I would look back, you know, you'd see them, you know, make sure they were there. My kids would many times go and sit with them because my dad would always give them a dollar. And so they look forward to that. It was a special memory that they have. And so that Sunday morning, I was preaching that Sunday morning in the main sanctuary. Pastor Berteau was going to be gone or something, and so he asked me to speak. And so I thought, I'm going to do something different. So I stopped at the store. And I bought a dozen red roses. And I put them underneath the platform, underneath the pulpit. You couldn't see it. And I preached my message that morning. I don't know what I preached on. But I do know when I closed it, I told that story of the funeral that I was just at. And I asked, I said, do you think that that guy knew that his family loved him that much? Did they tell him that? Or did they ever give him flowers when he could smell them, because he couldn't smell them there that day? I just asked the church, I said, if you'll excuse me a minute, I want to do something selfish. And I pulled that dozen roses out from underneath the pulpit, and I walked off of the stage and walked all through the center row there to the back. And I was kind of watching my mom and dad were both sitting there. I was kind of watching my dad the whole time, and I could see there was kind of a confused look on his face. And because I had these flowers, and he was pushing my mom, like, these must be for you, you know. He was pushing, like, stand up, these are for you. And so I walked to the back of the church, and I said, Dad, would you stand up? And he stood up, and I said, I want to give you these flowers while you can still smell them. And I said, I want you to know that I do love you. And that was probably one of the most fondest memories that I have, is looking into his eyes, this rough, tough guy, and tears rolling down his cheeks, tears rolling down my cheeks. And we hugged and we embraced, and I went back up and did the altar call and finished the service. It was one of the most memorable times in 62 years of my life, memory with my dad. Give him flowers while he could still smell them, and let him hear from me how much I loved him. As I thought about that this week, I thought, and I knew that these guys are going to be sitting here. I wanted them to experience what it was that I experienced that day. I wonder if there's anybody in here that brought flowers for Harlan. About Rocky. How about Pastor Marty? What about Drew? You know, without even asking these guys, I can tell you that they'll never forget that. Yes. And you know, you might not have brought your dad flowers today, but it's not too late. If he's still here. My point is this, is that if he is still here, you need to tell him that you love him, even though, you know, like as Drew was talking about, not everything's smooth all the time. And what I want to do today is this, is I want all the dads just to come forward. I'm going to pray for you. So if you're a dad, just get up and come forward. We do have a gift for you at the end here too. So just come on down. If you're a dad, come on up across the front here. Any other dads, you don't have to be part of our church. You can just come on down if you're a dad. I want to tell you guys this is, I love you. And whether you hear it or not, the world would never be the same without you. You set the tone for your family. Whether you hear it or not, your family looks up to you. We have a big role, a big responsibility. So today I charge you to be the priest of your home, to lead your family. Lead your family. You don't have to know everything that the Bible says, but if you have Christ in your life, you have the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit will direct you on what you should do. Lead your family. You are a blessing. You are a blessing. Some guys never got their father's blessing. Today I give you a father's blessing. Amen. Let me pray for you. Father, thank you for these men. Thank you, Lord, for what they represent, Lord, not just to our church, but Lord, to their families, and Lord, their extended families, and Lord, the people that look up to them. And Lord, I pray today, God, that you will encourage them and empower them, Lord, with the Holy Spirit. Lord, that they will be the priests of their home, God, that they will lead their families, God. They'll lead them in prayer, God. They'll lead them in Bible study, God. And I thank you, Lord, that you've never finished with us, God. You're continuing to work on us, God. And Lord, you won't be done, Lord, with us until you take us home. So while we're here, God, help us to be the influence, God. Help us, Lord, to set the mark, Lord, for our families. And I pray that today would be a day of encouragement for these dads that are here today. And Lord, and help us to be everything that you've called us to be. We ask those things today in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you give your dads a hand today? God bless you guys. So those of you that maybe your dad's still alive and doesn't live in the island or doesn't live around here, make sure that you call him today. That's really important. You know, my phone was going off this morning with texts from my kids. Some of them are probably watching right now. They've not texted me. I'll talk to them later. No, just joking. Our time difference, so it's probably a little different there, but I'm sure that I'll hear from all of them today. And so today, if you're a father here today, we have and you didn't win something, you're still a winner. And so we have a box of candy. What, it's chocolate back in the back, so make sure you pick one of those up. I'm sure your kids will help you eat them. Let's just stand. Let's close in prayer. Father, thank you for today. We ask that you would, Lord, just cause this day to be a memorable day, Lord, as we honor our dads. I pray that you'd bless them, and Lord, that they will have a great day today. Thank you for our families, Lord, as a dad. We thank you, Lord, that they love us, God, and Lord, they are our world. And so we ask that you'll bless them as well. So Lord, just be with us today. Bring us back next week in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen, amen. You guys gotta give those...